Well, thank you very much, Efka. We've just heard some very interesting things about what publishers are doing individually to improve scholarly journals. I'm going to be talking a little bit about what publishers are doing collaboratively through Crossref. I'll just give a quick refresher for most of you here about Crossref's basic reference linking service, and then get on to talking about trust and CrossMark itself, which is a new service that we're developing. When scholarly journals started going online in the mid to late 1990s, publishers, one of the first things they wanted to do was link their references. It's something users started to demand. The practice of citation is fundamental to scholarly communications, and it was a perfect fit for the World Wide Web, which is all about linking. So publishers started signing bilateral linking agreements with each other and using custom URLs to do the linking. Well, they quickly found that bilateral linking agreements were not scalable across thousands of journals and publishers. And the other problem is that links break. They're very fragile, URLs are fragile, and this undermines the trust and takes value away from scholarly journals. When researchers are looking for high-quality content, you don't want them to get a 404 page not found error message. When they do get broken links, users can get angry. It's not a good thing for scholarly publishers. The process of more and more links breaking over time has actually been referred to as link rot, and it's actually been documented in the literature that the half-life of URLs and references is something like two to three years. So after 2 to 3 years, half the URLs that were originally in the article don't work anymore. So in order to deal with these issues, at the end of 1999 and beginning of 2000, a group of publishers got together and decided to collaborate to solve the problem by using digital object identifiers, DOIs, and a central metadata store in order to create a reference linking network. And actually, it was 10 years ago next week that Crossref was actually formally incorporated as an organization. So we're a nonprofit membership association, a strategic organization. All the members are equal. It's a very broad church, many different types of publishers with many different business models. And 66% of the members are a nonprofit, and actually about 66% have less than $1 million in revenue. So this is something that's bringing very large publishers, very small publishers all together to create a very powerful network that's being used for reference linking at the moment, but we're expanding into some other areas. So at the end of 2009, we'd grown to almost 3,000 publishers, 40 million content items. These are the main content areas. We're also doing dissertations, theses, working papers, lots of other types of content. And a very important statistic is that over the course of the year, there were over 300 million clicks on Crossref DOIs. So that's end users driving traffic to publishers' content. It's increasing the visibility of publisher content as well. So building on this collaboration that's been successful so far, we're looking at a few other areas where we can help publishers add value to their content online. So before I talk about CrossMark in particular, I'll just talk a little bit about some general issues of trust on the internet. On the internet, nobody knows you're a dog. That's a problem. You don't necessarily know who other people are. There are lots of dubious characters on the internet. So there's a big issue about how you go about establishing trust on the internet. This is something that Tim Berners-Lee has talked about recently, the creator of the World Wide Web. And he, in an article in Scientific American, highlighted that, ironically, because the web was originally conceived for a group of trusted researchers, they didn't build in any security into the basic infrastructure. And so the issues of trust and provenance need to be built into the web. But things are so established now that it's very difficult to change what happens with the basic web infrastructure. He also then later said to BBC News, suggested that there needed to be a labeling system for the trustworthiness of websites, and then that there'd be different organizations labeling websites in different ways, which is a very good thing for him to have said this, because this is exactly what we're trying to do with CrossMark. So trust has to be built, of course, over time. I think publishers have done very well moving corporate brands online, lots of different types of publishers, some new organizations as well. I think it's painful sometimes for publishers to admit, but it's really the journal brands that are more important online. I think journals have done extremely well. This is just a random selection of different journals, but journals have transitioned online extremely well. And I think part of the reason for this is, as we heard yesterday, the article is still the unit of currency for evaluating researchers and the work that they do. The other reason is that publishers have built up over hundreds of years trust through their editorial and publishing policies. The registration, certification, awareness, and archiving. And in addition to archiving, it's really becoming more about access as well. It's the publisher's job to put the content online and keep it online and make sure it stays up to date. Despite, I think, some of the success, I think there's some issues that need to be addressed and that we're trying to address through CrossMark. Sense About Science is a group in the UK that deals with the public understanding of science and peer review. And Ellen Raphael from Sense About Science wrote a good article in Learned Publishing a couple years ago talking about that publishers need to do more to promote and defend peer review. So a lot of what publishers do, a lot of the value that they add is invisible, even to researchers who are fairly familiar with journal articles. The other issue that we see in terms of problems for publishers is this perception that the publishing process is complete when the final version of the article is published. This is deadly for publishers if people believe this, because really there is no final version of content. There's a fixed version of record that's certified by the publisher, and the publisher then also plays a crucial role in the ongoing stewardship of the content. It's the publisher who issues updates, corrections, retractions, and withdrawals. So there's the certification piece and then the ongoing stewardship as well. Now, the idea of the version of record is becoming more and more important. The Scholarly Publishing Roundtable report, which Fred Dilla will be speaking about later today, talks a lot about the version of record. And just to declare a conflict of interest, it also mentions CrossRef and CrossMark in a very, very positive light. But I thought that this focus on the version of record was very important, and they say that access, to the extent possible, should be to the version of record of the article that's stewarded by the publisher. Now, tied in with the version of record, versions of record can exist in different places, not just on the publisher's site, and they're also with institutional repositories, many different versions around. And looking at this version problem, there's an interesting example here. If I was looking for this article, I know the title. I put the title of the article into Google Scholar, and it gets me the result here. And if you see down here, there are actually 17 versions for this article. So if I click off on that tab, I'll see 17 different versions. We see up here that there's a link to the archive preprint server. And then this first link is usually to the publisher. This is the Astrophysical Journal. If I click on that link, well, I don't get very far because I get to the Chicago site, but the Institute of Physics now publishes the Astrophysical Journal. So part of the problem here is keeping track of versions. Part of the problem is that Google's not linking using DOIs either. If they were, this link wouldn't be broken. That's a different issue. But if I go off to the IOP website, there's the article. But I think, again, if you look back at these search results, I think there's an issue for end users. Going back too far, sorry. There's an issue for users because it's very difficult to figure out which version is which, and if there's a version that they want to cite, they might be very happy using the preprint. They might want to look at the publisher copy. So I think more needs to be done to label these things. So to summarize some of the industry problems, the scholarly pre-publication process is largely invisible. There's this belief that the publisher's job is done on publication of the final version. We have the proliferation of versions of content with the version of record not being identified clearly. And generally, trust metrics really haven't been established completely on the web. So that brings me to CrossMark, which is a project that CrossRef's been working on for a while now. As Afka said, it's in a pilot stage right now. We actually have a working system, but What I'm going to be showing you today is an early prototype, still going through lots of changes. But to explain CrossRef just CrossMark very quickly, I'll give you the elevator pitch, the very quick one slide description. So CrossMark is a logo that identifies a publisher certified version of record, and then clicking on the logo will tell you if the copy is publisher maintained and whether there have been any corrections to it. Also, there'll be a link to the publisher maintained version if you're not looking at that copy. And there can also be other metadata that the publisher chooses to include. So I'll get into that in a little bit more detail, but that's it in a nutshell, fairly simple. To expand a little bit on that, what it does is it, again, gives the user, the end users, a tool to see if they're looking at the publisher maintained version of record, and if not, to link to it. They can ascertain the status of the document and if there have been any updates, and they can access this extra information that that publishers can optionally register. For publishers, it's also important because, of course, it lets them identify in an industry standard way publisher maintained version of record, emphasize that they've both certified the version of record, but that they have this role of ongoing stewardship, and it'll enable any corrections and other information to be actually disseminated, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. So to go on to an example, what I'm showing you now are screenshots from the functioning prototype that we have. It's not open yet to the public. We're working on it with a small group of publishers, getting a lot of feedback. So as I said before, the things I'm going to show you now are subject to change. They're not finalized yet. So this is an example of looking at a journal article that's had a CrossMark applied to it. So we have the logo here. The logo, again, is not fixed yet. This is a logo that was actually designed by designers at the Institute of Physics, so thank you to them for that. I think it looks pretty good, but we're still working on that. So this idea is the publisher will apply this CrossMark to the version of record of content. If I then actually click on that link, then when I click on that link, I get a little pop-up box. And so this pop-up box then gives me a basic set of information about the article, and then it also importantly says this is a stewarded copy of the document, and this copy of the document is current. And then we also plan to have publishers link off to a standard policy, again, to explain what some of these things mean. So very quickly, the user will see the logo. That'll mean something. Click on the logo, and then it'll pop up some key information. And this is the very simple case, stewarded copy, there haven't been any changes to it. So looking at a slightly different use case, different article here, imagine that this article was not on the publisher's website. The way we're going to actually determine whether the copy of the article is stewarded or not is when the publisher registers the basic CrossMark metadata, it's going to include what we call a CrossMark domain. So a publisher may put in that this article, the stewarded domain for this article is sciencedirect.com or whatever the domain is for that journal. If that content is found somewhere else. So in this case, let's say the HTML version has been, you know, maybe inadvertently copied to another website. When I click on that logo, it does go off and check the metadata of the system, checks the domain of where that content is, and it can show up a warning message if that content isn't on one of the CrossMark domains. Now, this is an interesting use case because the way publishers will specify CrossMark domains is that it's sort of up to the publisher to indicate that in the metadata that they deposit. For an open access publisher, where there may be valid versions of record in many different locations, they would indicate in this CrossMark domain field that it's just open. So this warning message wouldn't then come up in those situations. But the basic idea here is that it says this is not stewarded by the publisher, so it's a version of record, but it's not stewarded by the publisher. And then there's a little bit of explanatory text about what that means, and then actually a DOI link to the publisher stewarded version of record. We might have to change this language a little bit, maybe it's a little bit a negative at the moment, but that's some of the things we're working out right now in terms of getting feedback. Another very important use case is that of PDF files. So users often download PDFs. We've heard that from RSC that that's a very common thing. And one of the issues that we're trying to deal with is that somebody downloads the PDF, and then there's a correction or an update to the article, and the user might go look at that article in a year and not know that those changes have been made. Well, yes, I guess that's happened to somebody before. So this is a screenshot of an actual PDF. We've got the CrossMark applied to the top here, and it's basically the same function. The CrossMark logo is actually a link. So when I click on that link while I'm in the PDF, this actually then has the same standard information, but the message changes slightly, and it says, this may not be current. The following updates exist for this document. So it gives very a date, the type of correction, and then again a link to the publisher stewarded version. So if the user had downloaded this article and the corrections had been made, they might come back and look at it 2 years later. They'd be able to click on the logo and quickly find out the status of that article. So we see the PDF use case as being very important. I should say also that the CrossMark is not designed to be digital rights management. It's not trying to restrict use in any way, but it's just trying to provide information about it. Users could, this would not stop people from taking the content, stripping out the logo, hosting the content somewhere else. That's something publishers already have to deal with. But if the CrossMark and the metadata embedded with the CrossMark are in the content, users may then start to question if content doesn't have a CrossMark, they might make them think. So there's a lot of branding that'll be needed to be done about the CrossMark. But again, if publishers are collectively working on this together, we think we can build up that CrossMark brand in users' minds, so they'll know that if it's missing, that might mean something. If they see it, they'll know they need to know to click on it. Turning now to another thing that we've done is we've added the provision for publishers to add extra optional metadata. Now, this could be about the various things that publishers do to the content. It might be the clinical trial registry number, things like that. We're leaving it open at the moment. We're just defining a very flexible metadata schema to deal with it. If you see here, when you pop up this tab, there's a status and a record. There are two different tabs here. If I click on the record tab, then it gives a set of information here. It says it's just a standard article. It's been peer-reviewed. It's double-blind peer-reviewed. It's been cross-checked in the cross-check plagiarism service. We're going to leave this open. We see a role possibly for the trade associations working with STM or ALPS and others to maybe help try to define this. It may vary by discipline. So again, we're going to leave it open at the beginning, but we do hope that some standards grow up around what type of information publishers add here. It could be information that comes automatically out of their manuscript tracking systems. So that's something that we need to look at. Another interesting use case for CrossMark is that we plan to make the CrossMark metadata available to search indexes with Google. So we have a Firefox plugin at the moment. This only works with the plugin, but in the future it could work natively with the search engines. If they want to play along, we'll have to see about that. But if I do a search within Google using the CrossMark data and DOIs, they can actually identify in search results publisher stewarded copies, the cross-marked copies. Publishers can have multiple sites again, so this could highlight the publisher site. PubMed Central could also be a stewarded domain if the publisher chose that. So that could also be highlighted in the results, and there's just an example on Bing as well. So with the plugin, this is actually functioning right now. But we don't expect it's reasonable to get users to download plugins as a usual basis. So once we get this up and running, we do plan to go and talk to the search engines about this. So that's a very quick overview. We're working, as I said, on the language. We're getting feedback from publishers. It can seem like one of the worries that we've heard from publishers is how much extra work does this take. So what publishers have to do is deposit a little bit of extra metadata as part of their normal DOI deposit with Crossref. They're already depositing metadata. This is actually the basic core metadata field. It's about four things that the publisher has to deposit in a basic XML format. So we think that'll be fairly easy to add into the existing Crossref deposit procedures. To display the CrossMark logo on a website, it takes a little bit of HTML code here. When the user clicks on it, that goes off to the CrossRef servers, so that does all the hard work. And we've actually created a tool already to help publishers insert the metadata into the PDF and the linked logo into the PDF. At least initially, we wouldn't expect publishers to have to go back and redo all their PDFs. Obviously, we would hope that publishers would join CrossMark and do it on a going forward basis. And then assess over time whether that's something they can do and go back to add that to the archive PDFs. So really what we're saying in terms of identifying corrections, the CrossMark approach is really just to enable publishers to do what they're already doing. Corrections are already highlighted. Systems are already in place to issue corrections, and often those corrections have their own DOIs. If that's the case, the DOI of the correction, we can automatically link back and update the CrossMark metadata. So as much as possible, we're going to build this into existing publisher workflows and make it as easy as possible for publishers to participate. And in terms of the branding of the logo, we see parallels in many other industries. Brand can build up very quickly around industry logos. Fair Trade, Dolphin Safe Tuna, the British Standards Kite Mark. There's lots of examples of this. So really, this is CrossMark is designed to be the sort of a meta logo for scholarly publishers. We're running the closed pilot at the moment. We'll be opening that up in a few months. And by the middle of 2010, maybe the third quarter, we're actually hoping to be able to launch a service, and it'll be optional for existing Crossref members to participate in CrossMark. So that's a quick overview. Thank you very much, and I'll take any questions now. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Ed. That was very clear. I already hear the sound of coffee cups, but I do think people also have a few questions. The floor is open. Questions? Oh my, I guess coffee is winning.
Yes.
Well, in that case, it must have been all very clear. Thank you again very much. Thank you for your attention. And again, for all the four speakers we had this morning, thank you very much.
Thank you.